I'm going to cover now is the Texture-Crete with a wood finish. And when it comes to the spec book, which is all digital and it's online and it's on our website, if you look at the Texture-Crete specifications, you will not have to try and dissect a specification to do these particular systems. We do have a Texture-Crete standard spec. If you want to install or learn about the Texture-Crete solar reflective finish, that's a different spec. Turn the page. If you want to install this particular system, the sample I'm holding up, Texture-Crete wood finish, this is its own specification, which is really helpful. So we are going to cover this system right here, right now. As you can see, this particular wood finish has a 1/4-inch grout line, which tends to be the most popular, and it is a very light contrasting grout. What we're going to install right now, my Vanna White, is showing you the darker grout line. And we're going to accomplish this right now with the pro installer, Mike Pittman. So first things first, before Mike gets started, we are back on preparation. Concrete surface profile, CSP. For this Texture-Crete system, it might sound redundant, but bear with me. We want a CSP of 2 to 3. What we need to be certain of is that we have that CSP recognized. And if you're not sure about it, then it probably needs to be profiled more. Pay attention to the surface prep that needs to be done. And if you're not sure, ask. It costs a lot less to ask before you do the coating instead of after you do the coating saying, should I have prepped it more? So you get where I'm going with that. So concrete surface profiles, 2 to 3 for this particular system. Pay attention to that. Pay attention to if there's any degradation to the concrete. And so what I mean by that is we need to pay attention to moisture emissions, a cancer in concrete, if you will. A lot of times you might have your own experiences where you see concrete is eroding from the sides and it's kind of spalling upward. And this may be iron sulfate attack, where moisture goes in, soil comes in, soil attacks the side of the concrete, and it just leaches out of the top of the concrete. In a lot of cases, you'll have what's referred to as efflorescence, the leaching out of contaminants, lime, salt, calcium chloride. If you see these things, don't just pressure wash it and keep going. In doing that, you're almost fertilizing it. We have different ways of dealing with moisture in concrete, moisture emissions, efflorescence, iron sulfate attack. So ask your rep. We have products. This is a SC21 lithium silicate. It's a part of our polishing line, but it's a concrete densifier. More importantly, I have a product that's called SC20. It's a sodium silicate. It's been used for years in greatly reducing the moisture emissions. There's no guarantee to it, but it can stop the erosion of concrete down below the surface. And it looks and smells like water. It's spray applied and broomed on. You wait 24 to 48 hours. In a lot of cases, you'll have an excess of the white fuzz, efflorescence, leaching out of the concrete. And people will call and say, oh my goodness, it got worse. And we have the dialogue at that point saying it's working as it's supposed to work. It's crystallizing inside of the capillary of the concrete, which is designed to mitigate the moisture molecule movement out of the concrete. It's really that simple. So concrete has been prepped. Cracks have been repaired. Now the crack repair for a decorative finish is going to be done with EC76, which is a cove gel. Todd, can I have that box, brother? Thank you. EC76 is 100% solids epoxy. We put 2 1-gallon cans in a 2-gallon box, as you can see. This is referred to as one kit. You can open the box. You have open 2 1-gallon cans, and one is half full. So now you can mix the entire contents if you're going to be able to use a gallon and a half of product, right? And it is the exact ratio that you need. If you're not, if you're doing smaller areas, the mix ratio is 2 parts A, 1 part B, right? So you can have measuring cups and everything gets measured. We don't eyeball anymore. That's bad. Don't eyeball stuff. Okay, so cracks are repaired with EC76 in the same fashion with the WP47 3-inch seam tape and sand broadcast over the top of it, allowed to cure. The EC76 is gonna take longer to cure than the EC72 that we used and showed you previously. So Mike is going to liquid colorant. Let me see that bottle, Mike. I'm gonna show you this, see how up close. The liquid colorant, and I'm gonna show you a color chart on it. Sorry for moving like this. Right here, so here's your TC40 liquid colorant. There's your color chart, right? And so the color chart is unique in that it's not showing you so many different colors, but for instance, so this shows what bark is going to look like in our white cement at 3/4 of an ounce, and this is going to show you what bark looks like at 2 ounces. So that's the beauty of this color chart. You can work off of this, and you can move beyond this if you want. But we have 10-ounce tubes of TC40. A little goes a long way. I'm gonna give this back to Mike. Little measuring cups. Let me have that bad boy. Yep. Another pro tip. I'm going to hold this to where you can see it. Get yourself these little measuring cups. They're like little medicine cups. I believe they can be purchased at paint stores, maybe for Z, you know, some of the smaller paint stores, but you can get these little measuring cups. And so what Mike is doing is 1/2 ounce of smoke colorant, which is like a charcoal, a darker gray type look. He is putting that directly into the liquid, the WP81, and 2 quarts of water. Now, when you use liquid colorants on jobs, it is critical to measure everything. You're going to measure precisely your WP81. It needs to be a gallon. Measure your water precisely. In this case, 2 quarts. It's not 2 quarts and a little bit more, a splash of this, splash more. We need to be consistent. Then, as you can see, he put that medicine cup, 1/2 ounce of smoke colorant into the liquid, right? And then he rinsed the cup out so there's no liquid colorant back in the cup. Then he spun it, meaning drilled it. It's blended. So if we were able to look right in there, you would see this gray liquid, WP81 and water. Now, he's ready to put in the TC2 cement. Same TC2 that we used for the skip trowel. Go ahead, Mike. ¼-pound bag. And I'm gonna show you one of these bags. So glad I don't have to lift bags anymore. So on the bottom of the bag is the label. There it is. This one says TC1W. That's for white. So all of the bags are clearly labeled because usually they're stacked like this on the job, right? So you'll have TC2 or TC6. So Mike's mixing that to a nice uniform consistency. No lumps, no bumps. The cage bit, another positive about the cage bit is it reaches into the corners of that bucket better than any other drill bit that I've used. So we went from the TC2 being a white cement to a nice light gray. And this is gonna be our grout coat, if you will. So we call it the grout coat because we're gonna put a pattern down. We're gonna lay a pattern down over the top of this coat, and then we're gonna put a texture coat over the pattern, over the grout coat. So when we pull up our pattern, tape pattern, you will see this grout coat. So you have the ability to do different color grout coats as the samples that Todd and I showed you before. So go ahead, Mike. And remember, pay attention to how he's holding that trowel. Most of the time we're working with the human being's wingspan. As far as this one person can reach with a trowel, paying attention to being nose heavy, no trowel marks. And another aspect of troweling surfaces in a slurry coat or flat is what's called chatter marks. We don't want the trowel to bounce and chatter, and you get these redundant chattering lines through the cement. This usually happens because you're trying to use a fine aggregate cement over something rough. So if you have an exposed aggregate driveway, you don't come in and do a slurry coat or a first coat with a fine cement like TC2. You would want to use something with a bigger sand like TC1, which we showed you. Something that can, you know, hide these lines. So it's, I always tell contractors, it's like sharpening a good knife. You don't take this blade and go directly to the fine honing stone. You have to start gradually and get the burrs out and work your way up. So as you can see, this system is very user friendly. Another pro tip is when you're out in the sun and you're working with this surface, a lot of people will ask, can I spray the top of this with water? Can I loosen it up somehow? And so in my experience, when using integral colors like TC40 and you have this light gray surface, you do not want to start spritzing or spraying water over the top of this. It could cause discoloring as you go. We've had people do that, and some of the solution is to remedy this is to make sure it's consistently wet over the top. What I recommend when it's warm out is having a Hudson sprayer with water in it next to you. It's a fundamental tool in coatings. Always have Hudson sprayers or Chapin sprayers, something in garden sprayers that spray liquids. Pre-wet the concrete. That will help the cements trowel on the surface before the moisture, the WP81 and water in the cement itself is sucked into the porosity of the concrete that you're covering. So you can mist down the surface that you're going to trowel the product on. This will greatly loosen up the product. You can do this between every single coat as you go. And then you're avoiding water on top of the surface, which could whiten and cause some white discoloring, and you're gonna make that call. It's white on top, how do I get rid of this? It's just so much easier to pre-wet the surface. This is your grout coat. Now, Mike is going to mix TC2 with a little bit lighter liquid colorant. I'm gonna go into that when he mixes it. So one of the questions I get frequently is, hey, it's 115 degrees here in Las Vegas and we're doing Texture-Crete. What can I do? My point to this and working in these extreme elements is we do have a couple of products. We have CA15. So this powder, if you can see, and I am gonna make a little bit of a mess here, but it is powdered form. This is an accelerator, and this is a white. So you go 1 quart per bag. Now, it may change the color of the cement that you put it in. This will increase the dry time of any of our cements, except for the self-leveling cements that we make. So the TC25 and 26 don't use the accelerator and the self-leveling cements, okay? So this can be added directly to our cements to help it dry faster. On the other side of that, the CA16 is a decelerator, and that's exactly what we call it. A lot of people in the industry will call it a retarder. And what this does is it slows down the curing and the drying of the cements when you need it to, if you need more time, if it's, you know, 108 out and you need to do the job, there's ways of remedying or properly manipulating the product. So I'm going to stand on the other side because I want to show you this board right here. And Mike has started to lay out a wood plank pattern on this particular board. Now, this is it 6 inches? It's like a 6-inch.
6-inch, yep.
So this is pretty cumbersome. I don't recommend that we go so tight on some of these patterns. I recommend the larger patterns. We got involved in a really large waterproofing project, and the client wanted this custom look. He wanted a tile pattern. And so it ended up, I think it's on our website. It was done by one of our QCAs, qualified contractor applicators, in a 2-foot by 4-foot pattern. Very similar to this, but much larger. And then we troweled on the appropriate cements and stains and sealers, and it came out phenomenal. And so then we produce images of finished product, and we frequently are asked, how do I do that? I saw this picture on your website. How do I accomplish that? And well, we're going to tell you. We know how to do that. So the tape that Mike is using is called grout tape. And it's CA60 grout tape. This is a filament tape used for laying out the patterns. And you really do need to use this. So there's your pro tip right there, is don't veer. Stay on track and use our product for the tape. Every single time that anybody has gone off the rails and tried to use their own tape, they get frustrated or have challenges with the pulling of the tape. The bleeding of the product as it's traveled over the tape can be really frustrating. Use the products that we provide. A lot of testing and backing up. So Mike is very meticulous in his pattern, which while he's doing that, I'm going to continue to talk about patterns. Probably the two most popular patterns in our Texture-Crete systems for the custom finish is tile patterns or flagstone patterns. The contractors that use our systems do more of the tile patterns and flagstone patterns than any other pattern. You can lay out a brick pattern. We developed a product called stone strips. And if you can look at this particular sample, you can see some of these grout lines here. The grout color is just a tad darker on this particular sample, but the product used to create that look is a product that we have made for us. It's called a stone strip. So it's a decal, if you will. And the nice thing is that it's not redundant. It doesn't repeat itself. It's not like a rolled out template where every 3 feet, you know, you could see a stone repeating itself. This is done. They come in lengths of stickers, and you pull it off, push it down, and then you can stand back and look at it and just make sure. I always tell people, I said, make sure there's no H's, really popular to make H's and houses. So you can always go back, pull it up and move it a little bit and get a flagstone look. You can put them end to end so you can make very large flagstone patterns, or you can tighten them up, razor knife them and connect them, and you can make small stones. Most people do a little bit of both. They'll have, you know, regular size flagstones with our stone strips, and they'll throw in some of the smaller stones, and it's all done by hand, and it's actually very easy. Tile patterns are a little bit more critical. They need to be measured, right? And so pro tip, when you're chalking lines, use white chalk. It took me years to learn this, so I'm going to save you some years. You chalk all your tile. Now everything has to be measured, and it's critical that everything is measured accurately. Now another pro tip is do not put your tape directly on top of the line, right? So you can see there's a particular line through this. This is TC2, this is a textured custom finish. But see this quarter inch line? So we chalk a line and you will put your pattern right next to it, okay? Don't put your tape pattern for your wood or your tile or your band or border directly on top of your chalk, because you'll be frustrated in the cleanup work that you have to do. When you pull your grout line, you could see that chalk line. You can see it very, very well if you use anything but white chalk. So I just saved you a couple of years of frustration. So stone strips, Todd has handed me the stone strip box. We sell them in boxes that will approximately cover 500 square feet, okay? So there's a box, you open it up, there's a bunch of stone strips, you pull them out. Stone strips are shaped awkwardly. They're not the straight line, which you can see, I'll hold it up against my shirt. So it's actually very easy. Pull it apart, peel it, it's adhesive, bam, stick it down. There's your stone strip. So Texture-Crete custom finish with the flagstone pendant is how you do it. Thanks, Todd, I really appreciate that, to make it showable. Okay, so now we have our grout coat. Remember, Mike put down our grout coat. Now we covered the grout coat. This grout coat, your yields on that TC2 mixed with 1/2 ounce of smoke colorant, the TC40, gallon WPA to 1, 2 quarts of water, you're gonna trowel it down at it's gonna go 140, 150, 170 square feet per mix, right in there, okay? So again, there's a little bit of a variable based on who's doing the work, right? And how hard they trowel. My suggestion is when doing flat coats or smooth coats or slurry coats, you trowel it to the thickness of its own aggregate, harder edge, nose heavy. So Mike is going to mix up another batch of TC2 for the texture coat, and we're gonna make the texture a little bit lighter. So the mix is this. We have a bag of TC2, it's mixed with WP81 and 2 quarts of water, but he took the TC40 liquid colorant and he is using 1/4 ounce. Is that right, Mike? Great. In doing broom finishes, and I don't want to just pass by this without not addressing it, and I was prompted to make sure that I'm very clear on when doing a broom finish, the product can be sticky with that gallon of WP81 and 2 quarts of water. So the spec sheet reduces the amount of WP81 to 3/4 gallon. Of WP81 and 3/4 gallon of water. So your volume is still 1.5 gallons at this point. Why do we do that? Because when we are dragging a broom through the surface, we don't want the TC2 cement to be so sticky that it just drags up. And in all the testing we've done, we found that this is the mix ratio that works best when you're doing a broom on. This is the only time that we're going to reduce and use this mix ratio. So to be clear, three quarts of WP81 and 3 quarts of water. Okay, mixed in the colorant, 50 pound bag of TC2 cement. As you can see, he has a bucket of water right next to his cement mix so he can consistently rinse off his drill. This is gonna be real helpful. I'm gonna move to the other side so we can see Mike trowel over the top of this. So the application is really the same as far as the product leaving the bucket onto the surface and troweling it. What I've always done with broom finishes is we're gonna trowel it and not bring it in so tight. I'm not gonna trowel it so tight. I just need it in place. I need the product on the surface fairly consistently, but a little bit heavier so that my broom grabs it is really the point. I want the broom to leave a texture. Again, always having a small pail with a little bit of water and a brush so you can brush your edges, brush your joints as you go, and then clean your trowel. All right. Your yield on this is going to decrease just slightly. So I would typically advise about a 125 square feet per batch. And when you're working outside in the sun, you want to broom this surface immediately. So that means as you go. So as the job is orchestrated, my suggestion is working from joint to joint. Have some starting and stopping areas and work in tandem with your partner, with your team, to where someone is brooming what you just applied on the surface. You don't want to wait. You're going to get better results when you broom it immediately. And a lot of times, the person who's working the broom, when you start getting into these tighter areas, much like a resinous floor, an epoxy floor, or even a stamp overlay, is working on cleated shoes. So he's able to walk out onto a surface without leaving footprints on the surface. Go ahead, Mike. Now, as far as what broom? So this is your typical concrete broom. There's several brooms you can use. Some people like the use of horsehair. And I get that with concrete. With slab-on-grade concrete, horsehair brooms leave a good broom finish. What we suggest and what we recommend is something a little firmer, because the polymerized cement tends to drag and grab a hold of horsehair as it's sliding over, and the broom marks change as you go. So use something similar to this. A lot of these gray bristle push brooms, typically 24 inch, will work very, very well for you. And working in smaller areas, you can get smaller brooms, or a lot of times, a little pro tip is I've actually cut 24 inch push brooms right in half, and now I have a little handheld broom. It's the exact same broom, not that would be cut in half, that I use on the rest of the surface. And then you have your extension poles, right? So you're working off a pole. Now remember, you don't want to take this and broom into the surface like this. You want to lay this thing down this way, and you're just going to drag it across the surface. Go ahead, Mike. Very consistent. Now, some of the questions we get are, can you manipulate the broom finish as you go? The answer is absolutely. You can do half circles. You can do swirls. You can do serpentine as you go. Most important aspect to doing these types of broom finish is stay consistent. Work from joint to joint. Right? Okay, so really good right there, Mike. So actually, the camera's picking up the broom finish fairly well. It's not ideal. It's not as though you were standing right in front of this particular sample. But you can see some of this aggressive broom finish right in here. You can still see the pattern. When it comes to doing custom finishes, wood plank, tile, flagstone, one of the most common mistakes, and I've done this many times myself, and I see it, is the texture's too heavy. They put the texture on too thick. And although I'd love to sell you a lot more product, you don't need to. Your life is going to be much easier when you put it on thin enough to where you have some of the lines coming through here that telegraph through. So you're just going with a nice thin coat. It's going to make pulling up your pattern better. You're going to use less material, and it's going to dry faster. So the drying faster aspect is excellent for production capability, what we want. So the other question is, how soon do you pull the tape? really as soon as you're able, most of the jobs, you need to be able to walk over the surface and pull the tape at that point. Don't want to let it sit, you know, too long. The next day, sometimes is okay if you finish a job in the evening, but you don't want to let it sit all day. You want to get the tape up because the cement will get harder and harder, and it could cause some challenges in removing your tape pattern, right? So, but there you go. So, good job, Mike. We're going to bring in the other samples where we're going to move on to water-based stains and show you some of the stain concepts. I'm going to speak to some of these stains and the way that they're applied. There's a lot of different ways to apply water-based stain. So if you can see this one, this is the exact recipe. And Mike just trialed this board, but the lines are pulled up. So you can see the grout coat that I was speaking to is this right here, right? So that's our TC2 cement mixed with 1/2 ounce of TC40 liquid colorant, right? It's your grout coat. We use the TC60 grout tape in 1/4 inch, laid out the 6-inch wood plank, and then we use the broom finish. Let's see how good I am here. You can see, you can't really see the texture, but it's got, trust me, it's got a broom finish that's very common and very typical to, you know, broom finish concrete you might see on slab on grade in your driveway, your patio. Okay, so we're going to move, we're going to take this surface, and Todd has the other sample. We're going to make it this surface, which shows up very well on the camera. This is done by water-based stains. So a little bit different from our stamp overlay, we don't use a release. There's no reason to rinse this board. When it's dry, that's a good question people will ask, is how soon can I put the water-based stains on it? When it's dry. It's not curing out like concrete, typical concrete that's slab on grade, where we mentioned, you know, we need a month cure. That's the industry standard is 28 days. You know, you'll see in master form spec, a lot of difference in drying of products that are polymer modified. So when can you put stain on this? When it is thoroughly dry. And that's going to be a variable depending on where you live, where you're working, how cold it is, how hot it is. So we're going to work with 2 water-based stains. And first we're going to put on mahogany. The water-based stain that we have, the part number is SC35. Beautiful, Todd, thank you. SC35, this is ready to use. So again, with the term neat, you're going to use this neat. You're going to use this right out of the package. In most cases, yes. Can it be diluted with water? Yes. Can it be diluted? Yes. With water, only with water, not with solvent. Don't do that. That would be expensive. So in this case, Mike is putting this mahogany stain, which is ready to go. Anytime you open one of these 1-gallon units or the 5-gallon units, make sure we spin them. The only thing that we've ever seen happen is as these sit, sometimes the pigment will, you know, sit low in the container. So make it a best practice, pro tip, best practice to spin the product in the container. How do you do that in a 1-gallon unit? You dump it into a 5-gallon unit and spin it. So if you can see how Mike is addressing the wood plank, he's doing this in what I refer to as an artistic way. It's an artistic appeal. So it matters. It matters how you do this. And contrary to some of the artist friends that I have, of just doing something, there is a very particular plan to the application. There's a particular plan to their artistry, if you will. Doing something with a plan, doing something consistently, typically yields the best results. So, water-based stains can be broomed. There's a lot of different ways of manipulating the application process of the water-based stain. The surface can be pre-wet. In this case, it was not. We wanted the most impact with the water-based stain right where we put it, right? Right there. So we wanted it to stay right there. That was the plan. Now, what he's spraying over the top of it is umber water-based stain. It's a second color to this floor system. Once you could use a third color. A lot of times we got involved in wood plank overlays, and we would use dark brown and black and sometimes some green. We would sponge on some green and it made it look like it was a little bit moss ridden. So there's different ways to apply stain. I do not recommend rolling stain ever. You see, Mike's got a small broom and he's using it as his application tool. This is my best friend. In all the years that I've been applying stains, I would typically spray stain on and then broom it. I'm using a 24 inch, this is an acid stain brush. You can use that. It's a phenomenal tool. Or the 24 inch silver bristle push broom as a 24 inch paintbrush, if you will. It works very, very well, and your production capability is through the roof. You'll be amazed how fast you can broom stain on a surface. So what Mike's doing is a little bit of blending to get the look that he wants with two color stains, mahogany and then umber. Did you add water to the umber?
I added water on top of the mahogany.
Okay.
Broomed it. Broomed it, and then I added the umber on top of that.
Okay, so just to reiterate, dry surface, mahogany stain.
Correct.
Water.
Water on top, broomed. Umber on top of that, broomed again. That's how we got this.
Sweet. A lot of different ways to achieve a certain surface. So again, I would say if you're that artistic applicator, play with it. Try the products, play with the products on boards. We do have liquid samples of essentially every product that we make, which is a task. You should see the team that does this. So if you need stains, liquid form stains, if you need cements, if you need product to do samples on your own, reach out to your rep, as well as all these samples. I keep holding up samples. We make these in production. We have 3-inch by 3-inch samples and production samples of every color of water-based stain, every color of water-based stain blends, every color of epoxy. We have system samples, like here's a perfect example of our stamp overlay, and it shows the system. It shows the concrete, the primer, the stamp mix, the stain, and the sealer. These are great if you're in sales and you're going to stand in front of someone and they're not clear on what the system you're going to install does for you. We do not charge people for our samples. We want you to have them, and we're happy to promote you in that way, right? So if you can imagine the workload that goes into that, and every single sample has edges that were sanded clean and they're all labeled. Everyone is labeled with every color and the whole assembly. So we got a phenomenal team that does that, and we're gonna move on. So now we're mixing up a water-based polyurethane. Let me speak to this a little bit. The SC65. It's in the SC category. This is a water-based two-component polyurethane. We have SC65G, which is it's a gloss, SC65 gloss. We have SC65 SG, semi-gloss, and we have SC65 F, which is flat, McT. And the reflective light on this on the boxes. Can you see this? I don't know if you can see this. Can you read it? Kinda, sorta. So if you could read it, it would say SC65F, and that is a flat two-component urethane. Now, it is three parts A to one part B, so it's a little bit different from the other two-component products that we have, right? But it's the same box. You have 2 1-gallon cans that are both partially filled. The 100% of the contents in both containers gets mixed together to give you a 1-gallon kit. Water-based polyurethane. And that's what Mike is going to mix up now. So when you're mixing two component products, this is critical. They are mixed for a certain period of time, right? And they must be mixed for a certain period of time. Your pro tip is time it. Almost everybody has a smartphone or a timer of some sort. And actually Mike has his smartphone out and he is going to time his mix. So he's got a much smaller drill because we're mixing a much smaller batch. In smaller batches, pay attention to the mix ratios. It's still a two component product, meaning there is an A and there is a B, but we have 3 parts A to 1 part B, okay? You can make smaller batches, but it needs to be measured accurately. Set your timer for the mix. Because if I had a nickel for everybody that just mixed this by hand and they were a minute and a half, 2 minutes into this mix, and they look at each other and it's hot out and they give themselves every reason. They go, you know what? The product's mixed. Give me a break. It's fine. And then they had challenges or issues with product not drying, number one, the product fisheyeing, the product not performing as expected or tested. We typically know why, so I'm just strongly advising, time your mixes. Another thing you gotta be aware of is not to whip in air into your mixes. This comes from anybody familiar with epoxy. You don't wanna use your drill and just get this done faster. It's not like the cooking channel where you can cook a turkey at 7,000 degrees and be done in 2 minutes. You need to slow mix this product. I would much rather see people mix with a paint stick, figure eight, for 3 to 5 minutes, consistently moving the product. Your part A is digesting part B in its volume. And you can see Mike has got a very low RPM on his drill, and it's just moving this product within itself. That's how we know it works at its best. And you don't want it to bubble or off gas. So there's a lot of different applications for this particular product. It's SC65, water-based polyurethane. Water-based polyurethane we're using it over our Texture-Crete wood plank. It can be used, number one, on concrete, SC65. The SC65 SG, semi-gloss, can be used right on concrete. The SC65F, which we're doing today, should not be applied directly to concrete. If you say, hey, Mark, I want to use the water-based two-component polyurethanes on a driveway and you want a flat, what I would recommend and tell you to do is do all your concrete prep, put a coat of SC65 gloss down, call it a sacrificial first coat, and put the SC65F over the top of it. Sometimes the matting agents can be a little finicky or hypersensitive to moisture emissions, moisture molecules, moisture in the air. And not all the time, but we've seen where they could cloud or whiten. We don't want that. So it's very important that you don't put SC65F directly on a concrete substrate. It can be used over a lot of different finishes. It could be applied over epoxy coatings, epoxy finishes, and it works very, very well in that environment. So it's really the polyurethane world is the industrial floor world as well. You know, we are using it in this arena as concrete coatings. So I want to stay on track with Mike. You can see the product is white or opaque-ish. We get a lot of questions like, oh my goodness, it's white. Is it supposed to be white as it's being applied? The answer is yes. And we may even see it clarify itself as it goes down. So you did not thin this with water, correct? Nope. So we're using this, remember the term, neat. We're using this with no water. If you are going to thin, and the spec sheet speaks to this, if you are going to thin the water-based polyurethane, the SC65, the G, the SG, or the F, you thin only with water. And you don't want to start thinning this too much. You want to thin it, you know, really kind of no more than 20%. Refer to the spec sheet and you can't go wrong. The application of polyurethanes. Remember, thin to win. Always remember thin to win, and you should have a winning recipe. Needs to go down. We're talking maybe, you know, 2 mils, 4 mils at most. And so, it's different from other coatings that can be put down, you know, at a much heavier mil thickness. We want to stay very, very thin with this. You don't want to work it or touch it too much, especially if you're outside in the heat. So Mike is rolling this for a second time and, you know, making sure he's got the consistent look he wants. Now, granted, we're in a nice cool area and the sun is not beating down on this. But if the sun was beating down on this, it would be typically, we would probably be doing a spray application, spray through a tape and sprayer. We mix the product for 3 minutes at the least. We put it in a spray apparatus. We spray it on. We roll it on. And you leave it alone. You can also use, get a lot of questions, can you use airless sprayers? The answer is yes. The answer is absolutely, but not everybody has an airless sprayer. Some of the painting contractors that we work with go down that road and they ask, and they absolutely, positively, yes, the product can be sprayed through those apparatus. Your yield, when used neat, typically on the surface, I'm going to give you a bigger window, is about 200 to 400 square feet, okay? So yields change based on the texture of the surface, the porosity of the surface that you're applying to. I always recommend two coats. We got one coat on this. You can see it starting to clear. That's actually a good angle. So you can see the whiteness up in here and then down here starting to clear out. This will completely clear out while it's cured. Now, this is a product that it's going to take 4 to 8 hours to cure. So when it's cooler or colder, when we get into the cold months, we see the product going even longer than that in some cases. Why? Because we're putting it on sometimes this refrigerated substrate. Some of the concrete we are touching when it cools off in the evening, it gets down into freezing. So proceed with caution. Check with your rep on when products can be used in what particular environment. We'll always do our best to answer those questions. One more thing is forecast. Check your forecasts. Watch the weather. It's real easy to put a weather app on your phone. And most of the people that we work at, this has become a standard practice. Is it going to rain today? Is it going to rain this evening? Check chances, percentages of rain. That comes into play. So if you were to call me and say, hey, it looks like it's going to rain tonight, and I have to put the SC65 F on this surface, what do you think I should do? I'm going to tell you, don't do it. Moisture on a polyurethane can cause it not to cure right. It'll slow it down, but it'll cloud it or whiten it. If it gets on it directly, like if it rained right now on that sample, it would rinse it away. And that could cause a lot more side effect problems than you think. And rinsing the product off onto concrete or into landscaping can cause major problems and headache for you as a contractor to clean up. So proceed with caution. But here's the pro tip in sales. Reserve the right to delay a job based on weather and forecast. In the proposal, you should have the dialogue and reserve the right to postpone a job due to elements of weather. It'll keep you safe. Okay. Do we have questions? Okay. Hit me. I've been speaking about EC72 as a crack repair, EC76 as a crack repair. So the EC72 is our crack repair. It's an epoxy gel. EC76 is our cove gel. We do a lot of epoxy cove specifications. When and where do you use either one? We have made it a best practice whenever we're doing something decorative, like a wood plank. Not the stamp overlay, but something thin, like the Texture-Crete custom finish, the Texture-Crete wood finish, to do the crack repair with the EC76. It it works better under these custom finishes, and it doesn't have a tendency to telegraph through. The EC72 sometimes, you know, telegraphs through a custom finish. So you'll see it. Now the spec sheet reiterates this. When it comes to a custom finish or wood plank like we've done here, we want the EC76 cove gel being used for the crack repair. The EC72 is a crack repair on standard systems or the stamp overlay systems, because you might imagine stamp overlay being a quarter of an inch thick, we're completely covering and encapsulating. Is there another question? The accelerator can increase dry times by up to 20%. So I personally used it doing jobs or demos or on-site demos up in Las Vegas, and it does work well. So it's only sold in 5-gallon pails, but it's in powder form. Remember I was, you know, reaching it up, and that was our white. We have white and gray. And keep in mind that the accelerator, if you add a quart of white or gray powdered accelerator into our cements, it can change the color. And it can be used in any of our cements except for the self-leveling cements. Do not add accelerator or decelerator, the retarder, to the self-leveling cements. Other than that, thumbs up and proceed with caution. I'm going to give this back to Mallory to take over for a little bit, and then we'll be right back to me. Let me know if there's any questions, type them in. Keep that going, and then I'm going to do the stamp overlay and finish this up, and we'll go from there. Thanks, guys.
Welcome back to Westcoat.com. For information on our Texture-Crete wood finish, use the navigation bar and hover over resources. On the left-hand side, you will find system brochures. This page will show all the brochures that we have for every system that Westcoat offers. At the bottom, under the texture coat line, you will find the Texture-Crete wood finish. The brochure has a picture and a step-by-step illustration of the installation. On the second page, you will find color combos that you can use for the wood finish look. You can also find, under resources, the spec sheets. Once again, you will see that all of our spec sheets are broken down into the four categories of systems we offer. At the bottom, you will find the texture coat line and the Texture-Crete wood finish. You'll notice that all of the components of any Westcoat system are hyperlinked into the system spec sheet. Another great resource on the Westcoat website is the markets page. Say you're looking for a coating for a pool deck. You can go to the area and click on pool deck. This landing page will show you pictures and have featured project profiles. Below that, you'll find all of the systems that you can offer for a pool deck finish, including the Stamp-It system, which we will discuss next. Once again, if there's something on the Westcoat website that you cannot find, please give us a call at 800-250-4519 or email us at info@westcoat.com.